Staring through the clear silver-blue water, I examined my fingers. They were red and swollen. They were different than when I'd been swimming in the Bering Strait, when they'd looked like the fingers of a dead person. They looked healthy, and I thought their swollenness would give me more surface area, more to pull with. I smiled and looked up at the crew, who were in the Zodiacs on either side of me. Each of them was leaning forward, willing me ahead. Their faces were filled with tension. Gabriella, Barry, Dan, and Scott were leaning so far over the Zodiac's pontoon, I felt as if they were swimming right beside me. I was sprinting faster than I ever had before, moving faster than the Zodiac, and I was getting fatigued quickly. The water was thicker than on the test swim, and it took more force to pull through on each stroke. My arms ached. I didn't feel right. I couldn't seem to get into any kind of a rhythm. Then I sensed that something was wrong. We were heading to the left, towards some glaciers. This didn't make sense. We couldn't land there. It was too dangerous. The glaciers could calve and kill us. "Barry, where are we going?" I shouted, using air I needed for breathing. He pointed out our direction, right toward the glaciers. I didn't understand. I didn't want to go that way. I wanted to aim for the beach. I was confused. I was moving my arms as fast as they would go, and it was taking all I had. From each moment to the next, I had to tell myself to keep going. The water felt so much colder than on the test swim. It had already worked its way deep into my muscles. My arms and legs were stiff. My strokes were short and choppy, but I kept going, telling myself to trust the crew and focus on the glaciers to watch the outcropping of rocks that was growing larger. I couldn't get into any kind of pace. Abruptly, the Zodiacs zagged to the right. I looked up and thought, "Wow, okay, we're heading for the beach now." For a moment, I started to feel better. I was able to extend my reach farther, and I could see passengers from the
boat
walking along the snowbanks. In the distance, their clothes lost their color and they looked black, like giant penguins. I saw smaller black figures too, real penguins nesting near the edge of the shore. For a few moments, I felt like I was going to be okay, like I was going to make it into shore. But then the Zodiacs abruptly turned farther to the right, and we were headed past the beach for another range of glaciers. Finally, it occurred to me that the Orlova had anchored too close to shore for me to swim a mile, so Barry was adding distance by altering the course. And the ship's captain was on the bridge monitoring our course on his GPS and radioing our Zodiacs, updating them on the distance we had traveled. One of the passengers, Mrs. Stokey, who was on the bridge with him, told me later, "The captain was watching you and he was shaking his head. He was an older man, and he had experienced everything, and now he was seeing something new. It was good for him. Still, I think he couldn't believe it." We continued on, right past the beach, toward more glaciers. "How long have I been swimming?" I asked. 15 minutes, Barry said.
Page 70.
I had swum a little more than half a mile. I looked up at the shore. If I turned left, I could make it in. I could reach the shore. The struggle could be over. But I wouldn't complete the mile. I had swum farther 2 days before, but I was tired now, and this was so much harder. I just didn't feel right. I couldn't figure out what the problem was. I kept talking to myself, coaching myself to keep going. Then I felt it. It was the water pressure, and it was increasing on my back. It meant there was a strong current behind me. I looked at the glaciers on shore, using the fixed points to gauge how fast the current was flowing. It was flowing at over a knot. I wondered if I would have enough strength to fight it when we turned around and headed back for the beach. It would cut my speed by half and could cause me to lose heat more rapidly. Barry and the crew in the Zodiacs couldn't feel what was happening. They had no idea we were moving into a risky area. If the current grew any stronger, it could cost us the swim. Barry motioned for me to swim past a peninsula and across a narrow channel. I lifted my head and pulled my hands directly under my chest to gain more lift so I could look across the bay and see if we had any other options for landing. There were no alternatives. This made me very uncomfortable. Chances were good that there would be a strong current flowing into or out of the narrow bay, and if we got caught in that current, all would be lost. We started across the inlet, and within a moment, I could feel that second current slamming into our right side at 2 knots, pushing us into the inlet. Without any explanation, I spun around, put my head down, dug my arms into the water, and crabbed into the current. I focused on repositioning myself so I could parallel shore again and head toward Naco Harbor.
A71.
Barry knew I knew what I was doing. But the abrupt course change caught the Zodiac drivers by surprise. They scattered in different directions, trying to avoid ramming into each other and trying to catch up with me. The motor on the lead Zodiac on my left sputtered and stopped. The second Zodiac immediately pulled up beside me. I sprinted against the current. How long have I been swimming? 21 minutes, Barry said. He and all the crew were watching me intently, their faces filled with tension and concern. I put my head down and something suddenly clicked. Maybe it was because I knew shore was within reach, or maybe because I got a second wind, I don't know. But I was finally swimming strongly, stretching out and moving fluidly. My arms and legs were as cold as the sea, but I felt the heat within my head and contained in my torso, and I thrilled to it, knowing my body had carried me to places no one else had been in only a bathing suit. I looked down into the water. It was a bright blue-gray, and so clear that it appeared as if I were swimming through air. The viscosity of the water was different, too. It was thicker than any I had ever swum in. It felt like I was swimming through gelato, and I got more push out of each arm stroke than I ever had before. I looked at the crew. They were leaning so far over the pontoons as if they were right there with me. I needed to let them know I was okay. I lifted my head, took a big breath, and shouted, "Barry, I'm swimming to Antarctica!" I saw the smiles, heard the cheers and laughs, and I felt their energy lift me. They were as thrilled as I was. I swam faster, extending my arms, pulling more strongly, reaching for the shores of Antarctica. Now I knew we were almost there. The crew was shouting warnings about ice. I swerved around 2 icebergs. Some chunks looked sharp, but I was too tired to care. I swam into whatever was in my path. It hurt, but all I wanted now was to finish. As we neared shore, I lifted my head and saw the other passengers from the Orlova in their bright red and yellow hats and parkas, tromping down the snowbanks, spreading their feet and arms wide for balance, racing to the water's edge to meet us. I lifted my foot and waved and saw my crew break into bigger smiles. I'm almost done, I thought. I feel okay. I feel strong. I feel warm inside. My arms and legs are 32 degrees, but I feel good. I can stretch out my strokes and put my face in the water. Maybe I can go a little farther. Maybe I can see what more I can do. Maybe I can swim 5 or 10 more minutes. Or maybe I should be happy with what I've done.
A72.
My skin is so cold I can't feel it. And when I stop swimming, I don't know how far my temperature is going to drop. I looked at my watch, 23 minutes. I'd been in a minute longer than 2 days before. How much difference would a minute make, I asked myself. How much difference is there between 32 degree and 33 degree water? Remember what Dr. Keating said. Once your temperature starts to drop, it will drop very fast. If you continue swimming, you're going to cool down even more. Remember how hard you shivered last time? Remember how much work it was? Remember how uncomfortable you were? This is the place where people make mistakes, when they're tired and cold and they push too far into the unknown. You could really hurt yourself. Finish now. You've done a good job. Be satisfied with what you've done. Go celebrate with your friends. Turning in toward shore, I again lifted my foot and waved it, and my friends waved back and cheered. 100 yards from shore, I saw chinstrap penguins sliding headfirst like tiny black toboggans down a steep snowbank. When they reached the base of the hill, they used their bristly tails like brakes, sticking them into the snow to stop their momentum. They waddled across the beach at full tilt, holding their wings out at their sides for balance. Reaching the water, they dove in head first, then porpoised across it, clearing it by 1 or 2 feet with each surface dive. They tucked their wings back by their sides so they would be more aerodynamic. When they neared the zodiacs, they dove and flapped their wings under the water as if they were flying through air. It was amazing to think this was the only place they would fly. They zoomed under me in bursts of speed, and their bubbles exploded like white fireworks. More penguins joined in. One cannonballed off a ledge, another slipped on some ice and belly flopped, and 3 penguins swam within inches of my hands. I reached out to touch one, but he swerved and flapped his wings, so he moved just beyond my fingertips. I had no idea why they were swimming with me, but I knew it was a good sign. It meant there were no killer whales or leopard seals in the area. When I reached knee-deep water, Dan jumped in, ran through the water, looped his arm through mine, and helped me stand. "Are you okay?" he asked. "Yes, we made it," I said. Everyone around me was crying. Susan Adie helped Dan pull me up the incline. Martha wrapped a towel around my shoulders. Barry hugged me tightly. Laura and Susan began drying me off. I was so cold, I was already starting to shiver hard. My legs were stiffer than after the other swim. The crew helped me into the Zodiac, and I flopped onto the floor. Laura and Susan piled on top of me to protect me from the wind, and we pounded across the water, my head slamming into the Zodiac's floor. I managed to lift my head so that someone could place a hand under it to buffer the impact. I was so cold and stiff and shaking harder than before. When we reached the Orlova, it took me a minute to stand, to gain my balance, and as I climbed the ramp steps, I clung to the railing and pulled myself up, shaking hard. By the time I reached the top of the ramp, my teeth were chattering and I was breathing harder and faster than when I had been swimming. I didn't like being so cold. I didn't like my body having to work so hard. My temperature had dropped to 95.5 degrees and I couldn't control my shaking. I just let go, and my body bounced up and down with shakes and shivers. Quickly, Martha and Dan and the 3 doctors huddled around me like emperor penguins, and their combined comfort and body heat began to warm me. It seemed as if I would never stop shaking, and I was completely exhausted. Within half an hour, my shivering had subsided to small body shudders. Once I was able to stand and maintain my balance, the doctors helped me pull on a special top and pants that had been designed by a friend. She had sewn pockets under the arms, in the groin area, and into a scarf, and had placed chemical packs that emitted heat inside the pockets. Their placement in the clothing warmed the major blood flow areas of my body so that I was heated from the inside out. It was effective, and within an hour, my temperature was back to normal. That night, we celebrated with everyone aboard the Orlova. I had swum the first Antarctic mile, a distance of 1.06 miles, in fact, in 32-degree water in 25 minutes. I had been able to do what had seemed impossible because I'd had a crew who believed in me and in what we as human beings were capable of. It was a great dream, swimming to Antarctica.
All right, let's pause for a moment and jot down to a major message. I mean, it's right there at the end, so let's go ahead and put it in our notes right now. Major message. Look what she says. The reason that she was able to accomplish what she was able to accomplish was because she, along with her team, had believed in each other. It's this critical theme, right? Critical topic. Of course, another major message here is, people, human beings, have a tendency sometimes to want to try what they've never tried before because once they have accomplished something, they feel they have accomplished something. It gives them a certain sense of confidence and ability, right? We said earlier in our conversation as sophomores, hey, you made it through your freshman year. That's an important accomplishment. It might seem inconsequential to some people, but it's a major deal when it's the first time you've done it. Let's jump to 2B quickly. Obviously, this is autobiography, and of course, we were focusing on author's perspective. Let's just put this in our notes. Self-talk, as represented by the italicized. When we find ourselves in difficult situations, we have to get through them. Often, self-talk is the way we make it through. Telling ourselves it's going to be okay, it's going to be okay. 3A, what is for you the greatest text of an accomplishment that you've ever read or seen? What is for you, and this accomplishment doesn't have to be a physical accomplishment, it may be an intellectual accomplishment, it may be a musical accomplishment. What is the greatest accomplishment in a text that you are familiar with? What is the text for you that informs you that when you're in the middle of a serious challenge, you gotta keep going, don't give up, keep going, or as the Nemo text says, just keep swimming, right? Which obviously plays well with this title. Finally at 3B, what is your swimming to Antarctica moment up to this point in your life? What is it for you? The thing you've done, you didn't think you'd be able to do it and you accomplished it, and no matter what else happens for the rest of your life, they can never take that away from you. You did it. You made it. It may not be a big deal to other people, but it was a big deal to you. And finally, what is your swimming to Antarctica moment that you think is coming? For many sophomores, it's graduation from high school. It's that moment when you walk the track and the balloons go up and the mascara runs and you've done it. You've actually done it. That's a major swimming to Antarctica moment for a sophomore. What about beyond that? What are those hopes? What are those dreams? What are those goals for you that right now maybe seem impossible, and yet with some help, with a community around you, you can find a way to make it. I hope you've enjoyed the autobiographic Swimming to Antarctica and an amazing athlete. Thank you.